The Agrigento interviews Curtis Yarvin, Sigma Male Strategies. On WASPs vs. Jews, Gay, Triumph of the Nerds, Shit That's Cringe, Fake, Gay, and Retarded, The New Wave of Critical Race Theory, Demosclerosis, and Hitler. July 3, 2021 by Niccolo Soldo. Narrated by Skeptical Waves. 21st century Adam Weishaupt is my standard reply to journalists who ask me how to best describe my lifelong friend Curtis Moldbug Yarvin. A practitioner of the ancient and respected trade of Freemasonry, computer programming, and intellectually powerful Mischling, his influence on political and philosophical discourse by way of his now-defunct blog Unqualified Reservations was so massive that I completely missed its existence. Tough Guy in Leather, the original Sigma Male, is my follow-up when media asked me to give more color to Curtis, or as AI call him, Kurt. The dual threat of computer programming and 3 AM political philosophizing have led many totally sane and completely normal people to try and convince wide swathes of America that he is a dangerous, existential threat to the USA, he is. Over at his new site, Grey Mirror, Kurt, as he likes to be called, has added another weapon in his arsenal. He is the Trefort of critical race theory, as you will see in this interview below, recently conducted at the Valley of the Temples, in Agrigento Province, Sicily. December 6, 1969, Altamont Speedway, Northern California. A young Curtis Groovy Kurt Yarvin stands at the side of the stage as Jefferson Airplane is about to start their ill-fated afternoon set. You became a hippie during the Summer of Love in 1967 in Haight-Ashbury, San Francisco. You grew your hair out, wore tie-dye t-shirts, tripped on LSD, enjoyed the buffet of free love, and listened to the revolutionary sounds of Quicksilver Messenger Service, Blue Cheer, and the Archies. Yet by the time of the Manson murders in August of 1969 you were already disillusioned. LSD was replaced by speed, turning the scene on edge when it was once happy and free. Shady characters with rotten, hidden agendas began to take advantage of the liberties inherent to the movement to screw women at will, telling them not to be uptight if they rejected their advances. And worst of all, for you, the Archies failed to score another hit after Sugar, Sugar. All of this was on your mind as you surveyed the scene that fateful afternoon. Fat women, high on LSD laced with speed, were taking their clothes off and making a run for the stage. Already twice you were shoved aside by the crowd due to the commotion that this caused. Is this what this shit is all about? You asked yourself. By the time the airplane began the other side of this life, you had had enough. You reached your breaking point as some hippie flashing a peace symbol told you to chill out, brother. Peace. You grabbed a pool cue that was left leaning next to one of the speakers and began beating him with it. It's as if an evil energy had been lifted from the entire scene. Bob Roberts, Hell's Angels San Francisco chapter president, smiled at you and nodded over to his club members to join you in beating the shit out of the hippies with their own handy pool cues. All this shit is fake and gay, you thought to yourself. It's all fake and gay. It always has been. Having corrected the crowd and having returned order to the scene, Bob Roberts tossed you a leather jacket with the colors and smiled at you and said, "You're all right. Wanna be one of us?" "I appreciate the offer, man, but I can't wear your colors. I'm a Sigma male, gotta go my own way." Bob nodded in understanding and said, "I hear ya. But if you ever change your mind, let us know." You handed him back the patch. It was at this point that you took off the poncho and donned the leather and hit the road in search of your next top Sadie. No Peckerwoods would stand in your way ever again. Everything is gonna be COO, you thought to yourself, fully accepting the fate foisted upon you.
Thank you, Nick. I'm excited to be here talking to Niccolo Soldo, the itinerant Croatian shepherd who, after a bad brush with venereal scrapie, moved to Tangier and founded the egregious Salò Forum, named after Pasolini's scatological update of Shaitis 100 Days of Sodom, set in the fascist rump state Mussolini created after his rescue by Nazi paratroopers the notorious Salo Republic. As a student of history, dear readers, I know my guineas and I can assure you that even Pasolini would puke at some of the content this man Soldo tolerates, nay encourages, on his bulletin board. And as for Mussolini, he would order this man's immediate arrest. Nonetheless, he has talent. Because I am a fag, I asked Nick if I answered this first, autobiographical, question in verse, it would be gay. He replied that it would be very gay. Encouraged, I began. Altamont. Half is what sucks about being old is foos who think you older than you are. No, I was not at the party where Burroughs shot his wife, I never drank with Kesey, though once, and probably, with Tom Gunn, I was made in the 70s, even that jacket, which I have actually ridden a bike in, only dates to the 80s, it was my ex's till 96, then her cat, disturbed by our chaotic living, pissed on it. We left it out on the balcony in Pacifica all winter, in the spring she still thought it smelled, and I didn't, so. Where are the singer-songwriters of yesteryear, Les Dames du Temps JD? Where are you, Meredith? Elise? Margot, the only woman who ever dumped me, not before sharing the hidden ways of the Brahmin Jews? Yes, I am old, then, I dated older, now, all these old women were imperfect forms of my wife. And now I too look more and more every day like an old lesbian. Anyway, though I was not at Altamont, as a critical race theorist I of course am fascinated by the idea of race memory, the theory, propounded by Lovecraft, that critic of all races, that men are born remembering the deeds, heroic or vile, of their ancestors, in which case yes, I was there, I did those things, more or less as described, like Tom Petty, I was born a rebel, my mother, for instance, was at Altamont, my father looks like and was a red diaper Jewish philosophy professor, who as a Brooklyn youth was asked to join the mob. I am what I am, my search precedes me and my jacket protects me. Anyone who calls me Kurt is looking for hurt.
Editor, WTF was that shit? Reductionism, by which I mean the focusing on one event or reason to explain other following events, is lazy thinking. Yet it does serve its purpose as it helps crystallize thought. The reasons for why the First World War happened are many, but blaming Gavrilo Princip for sparking it helps concentrate minds and allows us an easy and simplified timeline through which to frame events. If America does collapse, I can confidently point to the 1984 movie Revenge of the Nerds as the tipping point. John Landis' 1978 comedy Animal House involved the subversion of natural hierarchies, but unlike Revenge of the Nerds, the rebels were funny, likable guys. They were not nerds. Rotten upset the natural hierarchy where jocks rule over nerds. This is important because this subversion resulted in two disturbing future trends. A. Dominance of the woe-is-me-slash-loser culture of the early 1990s, associated with grunge music. B. IT nerds forgetting their natural role in the pecking order where they are the worker bees under the command of the alpha. And this is where I have a bone to pick with you, NRX, which you are credited with founding-slash-leading, and HB Dism are filled to the brim with IT nerds who are convinced that they can code their way out of our present decline. You claim to respect natural hierarchies, but coders cannot save civilization.
As a critical race theorist, I categorize you as a Slav, a sort of primitive, surviving Indo-European, close to the root of the chordate family tree. The Slav, in fact, is a sort of racial coelacanth. It is a small miracle that we find him in our presence. He should have gone the way of the Oscan and the Paphlagonian. And therefore, I find it surprising indeed that so eminent a druid of this petrified race would be unfamiliar with the basic tripartite structure of Indo-European society. There are only three kinds of people: peasants, priests, and warriors. The nerd is always a priest. The priest is always a nerd. When the Lord Indra on his chariot arrived at the Ganges to slaughter 6 million Dasyuvarna, the first and only word he spoke was Namaste. Was the Lord Indra a priest? No. Who taught him this word? A priest. Yes, as you seem to somehow know, it is only the warrior whose prana breathes life into the lines of force that weave the tapestry of history. Yet the priest alone can draw these lines. Can we judge the Lord Indra and his priest? Of course, and they can judge us, too. Namaste. The only alliance our teacher's pet regime fears is the union of jocks and nerds. It is the jock who shoves the teacher's pet into the locker. It is the nerd who convinces him to do it.
I've been preparing myself for this interview for over a decade now by purposely not reading a single thing that you have written. Everything that I know about you is second-hand, or even better, third-hand information. This allows me to avoid any biases that would arise by reading your Himalayan-sized posts. I have the luxury of being in the privileged position where I can judge you with a clean slate and clarity of conscience. A certain bureaucrat from Chicago has asked me how you feel about being defined as a techno-fascist. A Slovene philosopher has asked me why is it that most of your readership seems stoned and up at 3 a.m. in the morning.
Whether you know it or not, you are imitating the exercise of Nicholson Baker, one of the few writers a decent human being can respect, in his classic You and I, in which Baker surveys the similarly vast corpus of John Updike, without reading, or ever having read, any John Updike. Baker thus proves the theory that the true subject of the critic is himself, a dazzling razzia into the salty desert of the English department. To me, this theory is borne out by your own life's work, the theoretical construction and practical curation of Solo Forum, a wretched hive of scum and villainy on which I have never once clicked. However, your critical reinterpretation of the assassination of the Russian ambassador to Turkey, on the grounds I believe of an unnatural sympathy for Armenians, it was Orwell, actually one of the 20th century's great critical race theorists, who in Down and Out in Paris and London passed on his sous-chef's advice to trust a snake before a Jew, and a Jew before a Greek, but never trust an Armenian, as an Italian movie poster from the early 70s did show talent. I ask that you include it, as an illustration, below, if only so that those of my readers who find themselves disappointed with your bland, shallow and incurious questions can understand why I even deign to speak to such a Croatian creature as yourself. Editor, I can't find it. I would not compare myself to Updike, who was a genius. His poetry, though light, is actually quite good, and a sex fiend. I flunked out of grad school and lived the chaste, simple and sober life of a widower and family man. To call me a techno-fascist is sheer balderdash. I am a programmer, retired, a monarchist, absolute, and a critical race theorist, new wave. And I cannot imagine a Slovene philosopher, scratch a Slovenian, find a Slav, often not without some Turkic admixture, too, I fear, who is not up at 3 a.m., stoned. Projection, anyone? Your friend's remarks are not only absurd, but insolent.
The four horsemen of the apocalypse are known as fake, gay, cringe, and retarded. How much did you cringe when the term Dark Enlightenment was applied to NRX and to yourself in particular? I mean, it's intellectual dark web tier.
I can't comment on the terms Dark Enlightenment or even NRX, as I have never uttered them. This could be because they are cringe, or I might have a speech impediment. I am just a humble monarchist, absolute, with a small smattering of knowledge in critical race theory, new wave. I also like economics, poetry, history, and cognac. Any economics after 1930, poetry after 1980, history after 1940, or cognac under $30 is cringe. I agree with your four horsemen of the content apocalypse. Let's apply them to the worst thing in history, Hitler. If someone had told Hitler he was cringe, the Holocaust would never have happened. If Germans had known Hitler was gay, the Holocaust would never have happened. If Hitler's plan to make a multipolar peace of equals with England hadn't been retarded, he could have sent the Jews to Ireland founding some strange new race of splay-footed, bog-trotting moneylenders. The Holocaust would never have happened. If the Allied atrocity propaganda of World War I hadn't been fake, the Allies could have used it in the next war when it wasn't fake, and the Holocaust would never have happened. Therefore, the four horsemen of harmful content whose names are called fake, gay, cringe and retarded are the cause of the Holocaust. Remembering the victims, it seems right and proper for big tech to combat this kind of harmful content with ruthless, automated censorship. Can we dream of a world where Twitter suspends your account because you are cringe? Where YouTube hands out retarded strikes? Boys and girls, only dreams this big can inspire the change that we need to create the world that we deserve to be. Many have asked me to comment on the so-called intellectual dark web. Know this, askers, you asked me to compromise my dignity. Also, for anyone reading this in 2025 or later, you're curious, but it doesn't matter. The real dark web was the dark web we bought drugs on. It disappeared when they banned Bitcoin.
Clever Kurt and the Global American Empire, GAE. The death of the American Empire is greatly exaggerated, in my opinion. Everywhere you turn, one is hit by constant refrains that US power is declining on the global stage. I take the opposite position. The USA's power continues to grow, especially when it comes to areas like technology. Every mobile phone not powered by Huawei is an American surveillance tool in your pocket, for example. Americans will deny this by saying that democracy is decaying in the USA, or will point out how infrastructure is collapsing in flyover country, or Florida, as a few days ago, Ed, or how academic freedom is waning. There are many more examples that can be trotted out, and each and every one can be true, but they all miss the bigger picture. The bigger picture is that the USA is in a transformative state. It is shedding an older skin, revealing a new one. It is in many ways moving away from mercantilism towards becoming an ideological state where the original sin of racism begets the new prime directive of anti-racism. All American history, down to the once cherished founders and their words and deeds and actions and efforts, are forcibly translated through this anti-racist prism. And this new state ideology, we can call it a state religion too, informs and directs how the USA acts domestically and globally as well. The USA continues to institutionalize and instrumentalize domestic values on the global stage, which serve to allow for the destabilization of or removal of targeted regimes. And current US satraps and colonies cannot help but be influenced by the exporting of these new trendy values. France is already struggling with critical race theory that has now washed up on its shores and is causing political and social tremors on its own soil, to the point where President Macron and other leading French politicians have publicly denounced them as harmful, and where French generals have indicated that they are exacerbating a situation that will lead to civil war.
As a foreign service brat, I grew up in the bowels of the empire and have also studied its past. I can tell you that the global American empire, gay, pronounced gay, is neither old nor young, neither dying nor being born. People think the empire is old and about to die because wishful thinking is a thing, and the death of great man theory has turned everyone into a historical voyeur. Empires do not die on their own, they have to be killed. Automatism in history is a 19th century English Whig/Marxist idea which needs to be taken out with the rest of the gays' ideological trash. People think the empire is young and has just been born because they are used to all the heinous ways it has violated them in the past. When the gay starts to penetrate them in some new orifice, they are briefly shocked and revolted, but they take the saggy, worked over state of all their other holes for granted. Just relax, kids, you'll get used to it. Arguably, the gay is born in 1815 when the Battle of Waterloo ends the multipolar European order and leaves England the queen of the world. Its center of gravity moves from London to Washington, for basically financial reasons, after World War I. Empire is Lindy, and 200 years is middle-aged for an empire. Sorry. Drink more and try some muscle relaxants looking at you, France.
The USA is a liberal construct and has been one from its very beginnings. We are both Generation X, and we grew up in an anomaly whereby the USA found itself on the global right by default as it faced off against the global left in the form of the Soviet bloc. The anti-communist alliance with the Catholic Church, for example, seems anachronistic now in light of how diametrically opposed Western liberalism is today to Catholic thought and catechism. You are very much anti-American in that you reject the liberal foundations of your own country. The primacy of the individual, the division of powers, etc., are all impediments to proper rule, in your opinion. My view is that the rabid individualism inherent in the USA's founding is what has brought your country to its current state, with the assistance of the defeat of states' rights at Appomattox. The USA is therefore a failed project, so you too seek its radical transformation.
Yes. The USA was never actually anti-communist, just anti-Soviet. Instead of the Cold War, I prefer to refer to the Anglo-Soviet split. We should think of this conflict as akin to the breach between Stalin and Tito, Mao and Khrushchev, etc., a mere tiff among revolutionary bandits. America has always succeeded not because of its individualist ideals, but despite them. A country is a land and a people with excellent people and an excellent land. Early America could not go wrong. Arguably, individualism was even a good balance against the Spartan cult freaks of early Massachusetts. But every asset can be wasted.
Demosclerosis is the condition whereby entrenched political parties, that are actually institutions, manage to block or impede necessary or vital reforms. In much of the West today, including the USA, demosclerosis has set in. Elections are now regularly contested post-count as the results are often too close to call and require days, sometimes weeks, to sort out. Confidence in actual elections is declining. But beyond that, Western democratic systems have reduced themselves to the proverbial game of inches in which vested interests that control parties are so entrenched that they cannot be touched, leaving only the most minimal of space in the center to fight over. Ossification is the result. Meanwhile, authoritarian regimes like China are zipping along, building bullet train infrastructure across their country while the USA has yet to build any.
Demosclerosis, a term due to Jonathan Rauch, is, like so much else, just another euphemism for oligarchy. Actual democracy, aka populism, has been completely co-blocked by the 20th century constitution, not the document, but the way things actually works, in the following manner: the Supreme Court is democratically unaccountable by design, the presidency is accountable to the people, but the executive branch is not accountable to the president, it is accountable to the Congress, but a combination of gerrymandered 95% incumbency rates and seniority rules has left the congressional leadership and staff accountable to no one. Moreover, even if these structural impediments could be overcome, the Bhagwan has it right: democracy is government for the people, by the people, of the people. So, when the people are retarded, democracy is government for the retarded, by the retarded, of the retarded. And all the leading experts agree that the people are retarded. Our oligarchy may be retarded in effect, but the people who run it are generally quite smart. The problem is the structure, not the people. By authoritarian, you mean monarchical, which is just the operating structure of every normal and effective organization. The only way from here to sanity, even safety, is to use democracy not to govern, but to elect a king. If Rome hadn't done this 2,000 years ago, nobody would ever have heard of Rome. We would all be speaking Gaulish and eating snails.
You are credited with coining the term the cathedral, which describes how academia informs mainstream media, which then dumbs down the message for the masses and spoon-feeds them the radical ideas that come out of the former. The slippery slope fallacy has been shown to be real and not at all a fallacy, as we are now seeing how these radical ideas are capturing not just governing institutions, but also cultural ones as well. We were told that this stuff will stay on campuses and not make it in the real world, but this is already happening. The genius of the USA is in its ability to co-opt anything and make it profitable for business. This is why I view these trends as much more dangerous than most have up until recently. I have had long-running debates with friends online as to whether US policymakers are cynically using these trends, for example gay marriage, transgender rights, for reasons of power, but very important people in your country keep telling me that I have been wrong in thinking that it is cynicism, when in fact these views are now widely held among these types. This makes our present state of affairs even more threatening, as they are true believers, and true believers don't deal well with rational opposition. This is also where I believe the dorks of the intellectual dark web simply don't have a clue. They are seeking good faith actors on the other side where none really exist.
You still greatly understate the danger. Yes, there is no conspiracy mindset. These people are generally still quite sincere. We have yet to get to the late Soviet stage of bureaucratic insincerity. In that stage, even in the shitty Soviet Empire, which was vulnerable because it had the gay to compete with, still lasted 3 decades or so.
The USA preaches equality of all people in terms of ability, but purposely seeks out the best and brightest from abroad to bring them home, boost their own companies, while Americanizing these individuals. This is resource extraction, and resource extraction is a form of colonialism. The USA has never engaged in colonialism on the scale that it does today, as it is global. The best and the brightest are lured away from their homes to boost profits and power in America, to the detriment of their own countries. I hesitate to point out the hypocrisy here, as pointing out hypocrisy is the engine that runs Conservative Incorporated.
As I always say, World War II was the ultimate colonial war. When Kipling wrote about lesser breeds without the law, he didn't mean the Udmurts or the Dyaks, he was talking about the Germans, the final boss of natives. Now we have all the best Germans. We have all the best Frenchmen. We even have all the best Croats. I once asked a Googler which demographic he saw more of in the office: blacks or Yugoslavs. He burst out laughing. Heck, there are probably more Montenegrins, and you know Montenegro, don't you?
A guiding maxim for today is that of Karl Popper's paradox whereby tolerance cannot tolerate the intolerant. This smacks of the preemptive warfare of which we saw in Iraq in 2003, yet worse as it is a totalizing system of thought. In the days of the Ottoman Empire, there was a famous saying, "The judge accuses you and the judge judges you." The centrist liberal of today, seeking to turn the clock back at least to 2011 and at most to the glory days of the Clinton era, is not equipped to counter this force. They may score some judicial victories here and there, but that at most is a fighting retreat, a rearguard action. Yet the average American today, who is opposed to these trends, SJWism, for short, is not ready to accept the brutal truth of how it can be stopped, because they continue to believe in America and its founding principles. They believe that a knife can defend them from a gun.
No one who does not feel the right to rule, or still more, the duty to rule, will ever rule anything. Tolerance is one common cope of these limp-wrists, exit or secession is another. Cons will always be slaves until they feel in their bones that they have the right not only to rule themselves, but their enemies for their enemies' own good. That's certainly how libs feel about cons.
You have been accused of monarchism and or seeking a responsible corporate elite to govern your country. This was a dominant theme on your blog Unqualified Reservations. Since its actual ending in 2013, corporate America has gone completely woke. Have you reconsidered your position in light of the fact that it's now hostile elites across the board? Is this a failure of hierarchy? What happens when the elites at the top of ruling hierarchies loathe large swathes of their own people?
Ideology is overrated. Structure is underrated. Napoleon was a Jacobin general with a radical Enlightenment worldview. Nonetheless, he crowned himself emperor and even created a new nobility. Most people have a philosophy of their own and just go with the flow, and this is especially true of corporate America, whose business is business. 50 years ago, when the empire was younger and softer, business could lobby effectively against the academic industrial complex. It did that. Now it is the teacher's pet. The problem is the teacher, not the pet. But corporate America, especially startup America, is still chock full of little Napoleons, many of them, as you say, harvested from around the world, who know how to get things done. If the flow is right, they will go right with it, but they will not be the ones to set it right.
A very simplified view of political-cultural relations that you have presented has been that of Puritans versus yokels, where the Puritans are the coastal elites of old stock America, and the yokels range from the Scots-Irish rednecks of Appalachia, down through the Ellis Island cohort, and so on. The Puritan rules over the yokel. You have been criticized for downplaying how American Jews have influenced the development of the USA since their mass arrival during the Ellis Island days. In 4, someone mentions Sephardis in New Amsterdam. Would it be safe to say that the Puritan cohort fused with Ashkenazi Jews over time to create a hybrid political, economic, academic, and social elite that has dominated the USA since at least the LBJ era?
Yes, but all the cultural DNA in this union came from the Puritans. The Jews only contributed their genes. When the Shtetl moved to Brooklyn and then went to Harvard, the WASPs didn't start wearing yarmulkes. The Jews started giving their kids super WASP names like Irving or Sidney or Warren. In fact, they figured out who were the truly fashionable WASPs, and promptly out-WASPed them, a historic tragedy. This gay reality became the truth behind the international Jewish conspiracy. Take the South, there were certainly Jews behind Reconstruction 2.0. Where were the Jews in Reconstruction 1.0? If you can't find them, and you can't, you have an Occam's razor problem.
It's rather amazing that your country went from Obama's post-racial America to today's hyper-racial USA in the blink of an eye. No subject is more incendiary than race. The liberal has fully swallowed the integrationism and purported colorblindness of MLKism, but culture and especially politics have moved past that. The irony is that blacks in the USA are almost entirely powerless politically, beyond serving as symbols for injustice in which one set of white elites uses these symbols to hammer another set of white elites. For me, black Americans become politically irrelevant when they rejected Malcolm X, a proper revolutionary and nationalist, in favor of MLK's integrationism. Their end of history had arrived, albeit with a strong nudge from the FBI and their targeting of black radicals. Hashtag BLM is financed by non-blacks such as George Soros, and black activists were sounding the alarm early on during last year's riots, letting people who would listen know that it was out of their control, and in the control of non-black forces. With newer populations arriving in the USA, such as South and East Asians, blacks are being further pushed aside as these new groups find their footing in their new home. It's almost as if this is a last hurrah for political black America, because these new arrivals don't have the psychological baggage of slavery from which to elicit sympathy or guilt. At the same time, new fractures are forming. Asian Americans are now faced with being shut out of the system by way of degrading their access to top schools. Some will be allowed in, others will be rejected despite being very qualified in a meritocratic system. We might see a development whereby resentment of the new manifests itself in a reaction to the system, but pitting immigrant communities against their own depending on who makes it into the elite and who is left out. With all this in mind, it all bodes ill for proponents of white identity, even though the left is toying with waking this potential beast from its slumber by pointing its finger directly at it and insisting that whiteness is inherently racist and therefore evil. The trouble with whites, and by extension white identity, and its ethnogenesis, is other whites who are overtly hostile to its formation. And it's these whites that are now in control. Singaporean statesman Lee Kuan Yew said it best: in a multi-ethnic polity, ethnic politics take precedence over everything else. In a hyper-racialized USA, I think that his dictum will prove correct.
To find black leaders who were created by the community itself, rather than invented as astroturf by white, counting Jews as white, oligarchs, one has to go back to the likes of Marcus Garvey and Father Divine, as well as of course the Nation of Islam. Even Malcolm X is somewhat compromised, or in the Latin triple X division, Cesar Chavez somewhat authentic figures, subsequently poisoned by their popularity with the powers that be. I encourage the young, courageous leaders of corporate America, especially Startup America, to recognize this historical reality, and work with it by paying their mandatory black tax not to the usual bay shills, but to these authentic community leaders. For example, any CEO with real vision could become the first American business leader to contract out corporate security, or even HR, to the fruit of Islam or even Liam. Who dares wins? Of course, white supremacy is a historical reality. The ruling class of this country has always been white, and even the strangers it adopts, from Jews a century ago to Igbos today, are completely socialized into its ultra-white culture. In effect, your average Harvard Igbo is just a very dusky WASP with a funny name. I do believe in heritable personality traits unevenly distributed across populations, but these effects are subtle and easily outweighed by culture. Ever seen a picture of America's ultimate convention of young nobles Burning Man? Not only is Burning Man whiter than Google, it's probably whiter than the Klan. Physician, heal thyself.
Is a new right possible in the USA? A red line of acceptability has long been in existence just next to the paleoconservatives. Even as they were pushed out of polite society, they did not see themselves thrown into prison or designated as terrorists. Conservative Incorporated dominates the landscape on the right, but it is old and feeble, happily ghettoized, content with mouthing platitudes while collecting political loss after loss, completely out of sync with the times as it engages in Reagan worship, and wholly unequipped to deal with the radical transformation being foisted upon their country. Yet the space next to them on the right is considered terrorist ground.
A very difficult question. I avoid using the term new right as it is automatically self-dating. There are far too many new rights in the rearview mirror already, and nothing at all came of them. Ultimately, ideology is fashion, and fashion only flows downward. Ideologists often make the mistake of going where the votes and the audience is, which is short-sighted thinking. There are no short-term solutions here, and the long-term solution involves recruiting elites who can slowly teach the masses to follow them. When elites try to follow their followers instead of leading them, the result is a sorry and ineffective spectacle. Nothing useful has ever been done with Sam Francis's Middle American Radicals, for instance. It is not ideas that attract the masses, but energy and the chance of victory. Ideas attract elites. In the present situation, any good ideas have to be highly energetic, and they are not good ideas if they have no chance of victory. Never pander. It only shows weakness and arouses contempt, among both friends and enemies.
Crafty Kurt gets Kurt. The brilliant Phil Hartman once played Frank Sinatra on Saturday Night Live, where he hosts the Sinatra Group, a parody of PBS McLaughlin Group. He berated Billy Idol, played by Sting, for having contempt for his audience. It's what killed Dennis Day. Nick Land, the British political philosopher best associated with the theory of accelerationism, has publicly shit on his own audience in places like Twitter. Many suggest that this is bad form. I am of the view that it disciplines one's own audience and shows that you care.
I never say anything bad about my readers, not because nothing is wrong with them, because I assume that, being persons of good taste and discernment, they already know what is wrong with themselves. I will say that many of my readers are nerds. I myself am a nerd. I love nerds and they are responsible for industrial civilization. On the other hand, they are responsible for industrial civilization.
Mike Cernovich has a supercharged brain due to ayahuasca experimentation and nootropic abuse like Paul Joseph Watson's brain force. Is having a supercharged brain the natural state of the Mischling? Two of my best received interviews have been with Mischlings, Darren Beatty, and Anna Karshian.
I have never experimented with ayahuasca, and not only do I not use nootropics, I don't even sell them. Perhaps if I tried either, or even both, my Mischling power would be too great for the fabric of the universe to contain. I will say that this particular cross has produced many exceptional individuals. But my genomicist friends, for reasons I do not understand, are adamant that classic hybrid vigor is not a thing in humans. Readers should be dissuaded from experiencing an aha moment and going out to their garage to breed, say, Khoisan with Hmong. Critical race theory is a real thing, but this ain't it, kids. Further study of the Mischling phenomenon may be indicated.
Dinner starts with a ceviche of beef, the love child of Northern Italy's raw beef culture and the couple's interest in assertive flavors from around the world. Depending on the day, you may find lemongrass, cilantro, and miso perfect strangers across Italy canoodling with cured anchovies and handmade pastas. It's not fusion, says Francesca. We don't ever think how can we work a bit of Asia into this plate. If it makes sense on the fork, then we go for it. From there Francesca takes me through the entire menu, from the esoteric and unexpected fried snails over a dashi spiked potato puree, glazed pork belly with cavolo nero kimchi to gentle riffs on the soul food you'd find in a traditional trattoria, fried artichokes dipped into an anise spiked mayonnaise, tender pork sweetbreads with tiny candy sweet asparagus and a slick of Marzo's exceptional olive oil.
Raw animal foods must be treated with great care. Cooking is essential to the human diet. Just as Carlyle tells us that man is the animal that wears clothes, man is the animal that cooks. Every civilization must be judged by its physical epiphenomena, its buildings, its clothing, and most of all its food. Our era has moved only backward in the first two categories. But I am confident that, for those who can afford the privilege, we eat better than any human beings in history and in food, as in no other area, we have created a true archaeofuturist culture that neglects not even a scrap of humanity's culinary heritage, but has coupled it with 21st century science.
I strongly believe that transparency in journalism is important for a free society. For the sake of transparency, I frequently let journalists know that I am on pace to earn roughly $200,000 over the next year by way of my Substack. I think you should be transparent as well and let us know how much you are making. I have you pegged at roughly $750,000 to $1 million as you are much more popular than I am. How close am I to the correct figure? Have I underestimated your take?
Transparency in journalism is very important. But I have to disappoint you by reporting that I am doing only slightly better than you, and you will probably pass me soon. This is not because I am not superior to you, I am, but only because you only have sheep to herd, whereas I have children. Fortunately, as a simple shepherd you have no expenses other than Francesca and her handmade pastas, so you can live much better than me. However, I must remind you and your readers of a simple and inexorable truth about human existence. Anyone who isn't a parent is functionally gay.
You are very correct on your last point. You too can be stoned at 3 a.m., reading Curtis Yarvin at Grey Mirror.